It is an honor to stand up here and to be able to introduce Chancellor of New York, Richard Carranza. A little bit about him. Richard is a Chancellor of New York City Department of Education, the largest school system in the nation. He's responsible for educating 1.1 million students in over 1,800 schools. During Carranza's nearly 30 years in education, he has served in virtually every role, including as a superintendent in Houston, San Francisco, and Las Vegas. He began his career as a high school bilingual social studies and music teacher, and then as a principal both in Tucson, Arizona. Yay! Woo! A son of a sheet metal worker and a hairdresser and a grandson of Mexican immigrants, Carranza credits his public school education for putting him on a path to college and successful career. He believes that a great education changes lives. He is building on the city's equity and excellence for all agenda, which supports students academically, socially, and emotionally from early childhood through 12th grade. He's also championing initiatives to help educators strengthen their practice and to empower more parents to become engaged in their children's education. He is also a fluent Spanish speaker and an accomplished mariachi musician. Con un gran honor, I get to welcome Richard Carranza to the stage.
Gracias, Ileña. Buenos días a todos. Voy a empezar mi discurso diciendo que es un gran honor estar aquí. Quiero darle gracias a Eric, a Kelly, a Ileña también. I don't want anybody to know who I am, so leave that up there. Just a joke. Pero es un gran honor estar aquí en mi tierra natal, Arizona, Aztlán. Volviendo aquí en donde nací, es un gran honor desde Nueva York. Leo todos los periódicos, estoy al tanto de lo que está pasando y me da muchísimo gusto de ver aquí con nosotros tantos amigos, amistades, colegas con quienes he trabajado, con quien crecí y estoy bien orgulloso de estar aquí para poder compartir unas cuantas palabras sobre el tema que tenemos aquí arriba. Entonces, muchísimas gracias por estar aquí. For some of you that don't understand what I just said, I'm not trying to be disrespectful in any way, but welcome to what millions of English language learners are experiencing today in classrooms across America. Smart, intelligent, capable, they just don't happen to know the language of instruction yet. So I'm going to speak a couple of things about what we're doing in New York City. And then what I'd like to do before I do that is perhaps set the context. And Ileña gave the biography, and yeah, yes, I'm a teacher. I'm proud that I spent a decade in the classroom. I'm proud I'm a bilingual educated teacher. I'm proud to have served as a principal here in Arizona. I'm proud that all of my family, you know, when in the news they've talked about this caravan coming to the border, that's just all of my family coming to a quinceañera. So, you know, like most of us, we have big families, right? But I am very proud to be back in Arizona. But I'm going to ask you to do something with me. I want us for, at least today, and hopefully if we do this right after today, to stop referring to children that are learning English as English language learners. You see, because that connotes the sense that to be a learner, you have to learn English. What I would rather say is these are multilingual learners. And in fact, yesterday I made an announcement in New York City that we have changed our English Language Learner Department now to the Multilingual Learner Department. Because these are future bilingual students. And why do we know they're future bilingual students? Because I was one of them. I came to school, although my parents were bilingual, already speaking Spanish, just wanting to learn English, and now I'm bilingual, and it has served me and my brother very well in our lives. So these are multilingual learners. I would ask us to be advocates in that regard. So before I share a little bit about what we're doing in New York City, I wanted to make sure, and I asked Ileña over the phone, and last night when I saw her, I said, you know, how open can I be? So look, I'm not running for any office. My constituents are the 1.1 million children in New York City. Those are the people who I fight for, and sometimes that means I have to confront elected officials. Sometimes that means I have to confront the pockets of privilege that exist in the largest city in America. My attitude is, Ike, what are you going to tell me about my life? What are you going to tell me about growing up as a bilingual student? What are you going to tell me about growing up in a very humble blue-collar family? What are you going to tell me about growing up in a region where the only thing I would change about my biography is that my grandparents were not immigrants to the United States. You see, they never crossed the border. The border crossed them. This is our land. This is where we've been for generations and generations before the Magna Carta. So it's with that efficacy that I accepted gladly the invitation to come to Arizona to say that Arizona is at the epicenter of what is happening in education across America. And we followed with bated breath what happened not only during this electoral season, but what happened with the incredible organizing that happened with our educators right here in Arizona and other states across the country that stood up and said for the first time, you cannot look at education as an expense. Education is an investment. And make no mistake, and while we have very enlightened policymakers in this room, thank you for being here. If you do not invest in education now, you will surely pay later. Because right now, the cost of educating a student in Arizona is about what, $5,000, $6,000 per student? 4,000 base level pupil. I'm giving you the benefit of the doubt. But if you do not educate that student, you will pay later when that student becomes an incarcerated juvenile. That's $150,000 a year. And then when you keep adding the loss of revenue and the loss of tax base, and then you add the multiplier effect, if you do not invest now, you will most assuredly pay for that later. So it's incredibly important that we continue to talk about education as an investment, not as an expense. I want to talk about two things because I want to bring the context broader before I go very, very specific to New York City. I want you to understand that what we're fighting against in terms of education policy, and I understand not everybody's going to like this, but like my grandparents used to say, no soy monedita de oro para caerle bien a todos. My friends, you must understand, and I'm going to ask you to look at your data. Don't believe me, look at your data. We are absolutely trying to not improve education systems. We cannot be about improving the education system that we have currently. Because I will tell you, the education system that we currently have is working exceedingly well as it was designed to work. Now, don't trust me. Thomas Jefferson spoke about our education system from the very foundation of our nation, and I'm a proud American, but I'm going to tell you I'm also a historian. And Thomas Jefferson said that we should have a two-tiered system of education, one for the learned and one for the laboring. And that if, in fact, we did it right, we might be able to rake a few geniuses from the rubbish. Now, think about that concept for just a minute. Two-tiered system. So what is the evidence that we have that we are, in fact, operating within a two-tiered system of education? Public education. If you think of every indicator of student achievement and student success in all of our systems, and I don't know all of your data, but I'm going to ask you to think about your data, your college going rate, your graduation rate, what is your student achievement data, not just English and math, but what does your social emotional data look like? What do your suspensions look like? What does your AP college offering look like? What does your early education, high quality early education programs look like? If you look at every indicator of student healthy success, who are the students that are performing well and who are the students that are not performing well? And I'm going to tell you, if it's anything like Tucson, where I served, if it's anything like Las Vegas, where I served, if it's anything like San Francisco, where I served, if it's anything like Houston, where I served, or it's anything like New York City, where I currently serve, I will tell you that invariably the students that are performing the best and doing the best in the system are our white, Asian, privileged students. And I don't mean that they're all the same. And the students that invariably are not doing well are African American, are Black and Latino students. I don't use the term Hispanic as a political term imposed for census. We're Latinos. So I'm going to ask you, either in all of those systems that I've been part of, from the West Coast to the East Coast, either it's because Black and Latino students biologically, physiologically, genealogically cannot, they're incapable of doing well in a public school system, or perhaps the public school systems have not been set up to adequately support, to actually empower and help students do well. What is the evidence? Check your evidence. So I'm going to ask us today that as we think about how do we invest, the fact that I left Arizona almost 20 years ago, and we still don't have full day kindergarten in every single one of our schools, is not okay. And I'm not here to indict Arizona because I'm going to talk a little bit about New York. But what I'm saying is that our time is now. It is a critical juncture in America. It is a critical juncture for us to not be passive and not to put the white gloves on in a very nice tea party and talk very elegantly about what the challenges of educational policy are. It's time to get real about what the policy is. And I want to thank Senator Quesada, because Senator Quesada said something on that panel. The panel was fantastic, by the way. But Senator Quesada said something that I think is really, really important for us. He said, we must always, always not, what was it he said? We must be vigilant, okay? So in that sense, I want to give you three numbers to keep in mind. It's not a math problem, but if you want to do the math, you can do the math. Here are your three numbers. 64, 10, 23. 64, 10, 23. Now, why are those three numbers so important? If we don't remember anything today, please remember these three numbers, 64. 64 is important because 64 years ago, the highest court in the land, the United States Supreme Court, ruled in Brown versus Board of Education that segregation and separate was never equal, especially in education. And when the Supreme Court ruled in Brown versus Board of Education, they said, and by the way, that was a combination of many cases, one of which came from California, Westminster, which talked about the segregation education of Latino children. But in Brown versus Education, it was very clear that our students must be integrated and they must have equal education. We had panelists that talked very, very articulately about the difference between equality and inequality, equity and equality. I think that's really, really important. But the Supreme Court said you should not have a distinction. And we now have much research that shows when students are educated in an integrated way, all students do well. But my question is, 64 years later, what do we have to show for Brown versus Board of Education? I will tell you that the system that I lead has already been demonstrated by several research studies to be the most segregated school system in America. And you would think, whoa, New York City, the land of progressives, solidly blue state, lots of people that talk about loving the kids. I'm almost embarrassed to say this, and I'm not saying it to brag, I'm just saying it's the fact. We spend $24,000 per student to educate our children in New York. So you would think, what do you mean you're the most segregated system? We are the most segregated system because to this day, certain kids go to certain schools, and there are systems that have been created that keep certain students in certain schools and allow other students to go to other schools. So as you look at your systems, I want you to think about, do we have systems and structures? Do we have policies and practices? Do we have political orientations in our school system that create that kind of segregation in our schools? So 64 is important because 64 years later, I would very humbly state to you, as a native son of Arizona, from the West Coast to the East Coast, we have not fulfilled the mandate of the Supreme Court in Brown versus Board of Education. So then what does 10 have to do with anything? Well, I don't know where you were 10 years ago, but I remember where I was 10 years ago this month in November. And it was cold and I was in Las Vegas and I was watching the returns come in. And I was jubilant and I was elated because we as a nation had elected the first black president of the United States. Now, I don't know what your politics are. I don't care what your politics are, but it was historic. Because never in my lifetime did I think we would elect a black man president of the United States, and here he was. And he was articulate. He was well-educated. He was everything that we say we want in a president. When his words should have lifted us, he lifted us. When his words needed to comfort us, he comforted us. 10 years ago, it seems like so many more years. But what I would say to you, as good as we felt that night, we were lulled into a false sense of complacency. We had, as the good Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King said, we had reached the mountaintop. We had seen over that mountaintop. We had elected a black man president. We are in a post-racial society. Racism doesn't exist anymore. We elected somebody president that's black. Vigilance, as a good senator said, is incredibly important for us. So then what does 23 have to do with that? Because you see, after those 10 years, for the last 23 months, we've been living a very different reality in the United States of America. And that reality is, regardless of what the political agenda is, I will tell you, there is a deafening silence coming out of Washington, D.C. around enlightened educational policy, where policies that protect LGBTQ youth are being rolled back, where policies that protect students from predatory college lenders are being rolled back, where civil rights legislation is being rolled back. And at the same time, vouchers and charters and the privatization of public schools has become the agenda. There's a vacuum in education policy coming out of Washington, D.C. But it doesn't stop there. Because you see, if you go to any one of the 1,800 schools in New York City, where 71% of those 1.1 million students are black or Latino, 71%, and you go to certain neighborhoods, and parents have opportunities to come to science nights, or to the literacy night, or to the poetry slam night. And in those 23 months, you have seen a marked decline of parental attendance, of parental, what I would call, involvement with their feet. Why? Not because they don't like their schools, because they're petrified when they leave their home getting to the school. Are they going to get picked up? Are they going to get stopped? Are they going to be questioned? And they're petrified that they may never get home. You see, words matter, and that's the environment that's been created in these 23 months. An environment where vast groups of people are called rapists and murderers and drug dealers. They just happen to look like me. In fact, I started growing my mustache and goatee after this guy got elected because I want to say, eat gay. Where babies are ripped from their mother's arms and put in cages. Where right now in New York City there are over 4,000 detained children. 4,000 that have not received education for over 60 days. Where the mayor and I have written to every official in the government saying, we will educate them, we will send teachers there, we will provide curriculum, we will provide social workers, we will provide counselors, and we have been told, no, it's not the policy. So my friends, if we do not pay attention to the 64 and understand that the complacency that came with the 10 has led directly to this 23, then we are endangering our children. Not in New York City, not just in Arizona, but in America. And part of that is because America is becoming more and more like those black and brown children in the very system that was created to not necessarily serve them well. Are you with me? That is the reason I'm here with UnidosUS, because the work that they're doing across the country and the policy work that they're doing is the right work. We need to use the data. We need to use the equity systems. We need to highlight where not only the capital investments and the maintenance and operation investments have not been sufficient to educate our children for a 21st century education. In fact, an education which we don't even know exactly what that's going to look like, those jobs are going to look like in 3, 5, 10, 15 years from now. So if we continue to educate students on an outdated model, we'll never get to where we need to be. So I could have come up here and talked to you about the transforming communities through multilingualism in New York City, and I'm going to do that. I'm going to take you through that very quickly, just so you have an idea what we're doing. But I'm also going to say to you, my friends, and again, I'm an invited guest, so I get to get on a plane and leave. And with all due respect to everyone here, if I was still in Arizona, the number one thing that I would be rallying every community in this state to do is to oppose that four-hour mandatory English instruction. It is not research-based. It is not research-based, and it inhibits educators from doing the work that they need to do. So why is this important? So let me tell you a little bit about New York City and why it's important what we've done in New York City, not because it's the thing to do, it's just one of the things to do. How am I doing on time? Okay? Okay. Our New York City Department of Education multi-learner population, no longer English learner population. We're 1.1 million students, 1,800 schools. The number of students with home languages other than English are 459,000 students. We have students enrolled in our public schools that are identified as English language learners or multilingual learners at 153,000 students. These are bigger than some of the populations in some states. When you think about those 159 languages that are spoken in New York City's public schools, the top 10 languages, number one is Spanish. The 10th language is Punjabi, and everything in between. So when you think about, well, the number one language other than English spoken is Spanish, and that's 61% of the English language learners. My friends, that's 94,000 students. So these are significant numbers of children. The least spoken language is 964 Punjabi. When we think about where our students born for our multilingual learners in New York City, most of them are born in the United States. Is that a surprise to anybody? Most of them in your school systems are probably born in the United States as well. But we also have significant representation. I'm a proud Mexicano in New York City, but the biggest Latino population is the Dominican, our Dominican population, followed by Puerto Ricans, right? Most people would have thought Puerto Ricans number one, but the Dominicans, hey, they're populating, okay? But I gotta tell you, the Mexican population is also growing very, very quickly. An overall review of our program. We have something we call English as a New Language. It was formerly known as English as a Second Language, ESL. But what we've done is taken a research-based approach, English language development. We really focus on content area instruction in English with home language supports and appropriate scaffolding. This is what I'm talking about. If we were trying to do this right now, with all due respect, con mucho cariño, in Arizona, we couldn't do this in the current model. And it's, again, research-based. Our English as a New Language is delivered through standalone models, or it can also be integrated in an ENL model, and we have many schools that do that. Unfortunately, I'm not proud of this, but we have transitional bilingual education programs and dual language programs, and you're thinking, why are you not proud of that? Because I also believe in a maintenance bilingual education program. State law currently doesn't allow us to do that, so we only have a transitional bilingual program. But it's what it is. So students learn in a bilingual model, they value both languages. In a dual language program, we do a 50-50 model, and we start in pre-K. So we have pre-K, we have universal high quality pre-K in New York City. That means every four-year-old in New York City, free of charge, free 99, gets a high quality pre-K program, regardless of income, regardless of social status. We've also just added over the last year a 3K program, which we're gradually rolling out. And by 2020-21, it will also be universal. So we're going to be educating, we're adding two grade levels to our, what used to be K-12 system. And all of those programs have within them dual language programs and also bilingual model programs. Just to give you an idea of size, in our dual language pre-K alone, there's 107 pre-K sites that have the dual language program in 9 different languages. Bengali, Chinese, French, Haitian, Creole, Hebrew, Italian, Japanese, Russian, Spanish. We just added an Albanian to that as well. We have our dual language programs in our K-12 portfolio of schools. We have 244 with 11 languages, including Arabic. And in our transitional bilingual education programs, we have 301 in our K-12 portfolio, including 7 languages, which are listed there. Our bilingual program expansion that happened between 2015 and 17, we invested almost $200 million in growing our programs. 146 new K-12 programs, we added 108 dual language programs. We opened dual language programs addressing low incidence languages in New York City, which is our way of saying languages that don't have a big population, but have enough of a population that they're viable. Those would be Japanese, Polish, and Urdu. We have 86 elementary schools, 36 middle schools, and 24 high schools. And you might ask, if you have such a large portfolio, why don't you have a bigger presence? So one of the things that I brought when I first started as chancellor is do an audit of our programs. And one of the things that we found was that while we had a robust offering in our elementary schools, we hadn't paid particular attention to having an articulated program all the way from middle school through high school. So our goal is that our students will graduate with a seal of biliteracy, which is one of my legislative priorities this year in Albany. And in order to do this, we understand that you just can't do this nilly-willy. So one of the things that we do is we start by surveying communities and asking communities if they have an interest in a bilingual or a dual language program. And when they do, we have over $3 million that we've put aside to give schools support for materials, for instructional supplies. Some of it is for a convening process so that we bring all stakeholders to the table. Our principals, assistant principals, and teachers participate in a series of professional development workshops. They're led by nationally recognized bilingual experts. So we want our communities to understand, if you're making a commitment to bilingual program, dual language program, this is what you're signing up for. And that has been really, really important, because there's been several instances where people have said, didn't know it was going to be that, okay? And that's okay. But we want to make sure we have a coalition of the willing. And then we have parent engagement workshops focused on the choices, dual language, transitional, and then we offer inter-site visits so they can go see what one of these programs looks like. I drop in unannounced on some of these visits, and it freaks people out, but it's really good to hear what people are talking about as they're kind of looking at these programs. One of the things I was asked to talk about is, so what's your strategic sustainability for these K-12 bilingual programming? It's all through collaboration. It has to be based and predicated on collaboration. So when we identify potential new programs, this is centrally what we do. We have to look at, do we have the capacity in our division of multilingual learners to support the development of new programs? And by the way, the answer is always yes. Because if we don't have the capacity, one of the things that is really cool about being chancellor is I get to say, we're going to allocate more dollars to that, right? The Division of Specialized Instruction and Student Support, special ed. Because one of the things that we all know in our dual language programs is that oftentimes it becomes a barrier for students with disabilities to access some of those programs, or students with language needs get misidentified as students with disabilities. So we want to be really careful about that. Space planning, enrollment, budget, and finance. We do our analysis to make sure we're ready to go. Then we review and vet those programs. We have, in New York City, as you can imagine, it's a big city. We have 5 boroughs. Our smallest borough is Staten Island. It's Staten Island with its own independent school district. It'd be the 13th largest school district in America, bigger than Boston Public Schools. It's big. So what we've done is kind of decentralized. We have 8 field support centers that have the robust services of curriculum, instruction, operations, all closest to those communities. Those are involved in the analysis, so it's a real-time analysis. And then I have 46 superintendents in New York City. 46. So all 46 of those superintendents must be involved, because they'll provide the guidance in those schools. So we make sure our superintendents are involved. Those superintendents are supervised by executive superintendents. They have to be involved. And then again, the new programs are selected when everybody is in agreement. Yep, we're ready to go. It's the checklist. Yep, we're ready to go. So what we're trying to do is systematize it so that we don't set people up for failure. I will tell you this. As a bilingual educator, one of the most frustrating things for me as a bilingual teacher was that I oftentimes was a week ahead of my students, because I was finding materials in the other language and translating and creating my materials a week before. It was exhausting. And I can't honestly tell you, if I was still a bilingual educator in a bilingual classroom with the same conditions, if I could survive 30 years in the classroom. It was exhausting, I'm just being honest. So one of the things that we want to make sure is that we have the capacity to provide that support, the instructional support, the unit support, the material support. It's vetted, it's rigorous, it's aligned to state standards, and we can stand behind it. The data that we use, I kind of talked about this. What are the enrollment patterns? Do parents have a need or a want? What are the heat maps to identify school and district needs? That's one of those New York things. I don't know if you guys use it here, but we use a heat map, right? So we ask a question, We do a survey, and then we say, where do most of those survey answers come up positive? The heat map, where it's really hot, it's where people really want it. And then we do a budget analysis. What does that look like? I would just share with you that our operating budget this year is $32.3 billion. So the New York City Department of Education's budget's bigger than 9 states in the United States. But with that $32.3 billion budget, there's a lot of pull on that budget, as you well know. So it becomes incredibly important that we do this budget analysis, because, you know, $32.3 billion, you would think, well, you've got a ton of places to pull money. You don't. Okay, so we want to make sure that we have the money to support it. And then here's what we've just put out, so people understand what we're doing in New York City. In September this year, I announced 48 new bilingual programs, including the first Albanian dual language program. We have partnerships with institutes of higher education to provide bilingual certifications to teachers. So if you have a bilingual Albanian or a dual language Albanian program, it stands to reason you're going to need a teacher that's fluent in what? Albanian, right? So where are you going to get them? Where are you going to certify them? How are you going to support them? So it's critical that we have these partnerships with our institutions of higher learning, so that we're, as we're identifying those needs, that they're helping us to be able to create the programs to certify and support our teachers. We offer professional development that's differentiated for bilingual schools. It's based on the type of program, the type of language, and the years of implementation. And then we develop guidance documents for bilingual programs that include all of those things that are up there: planning, curriculum, resource, guiding principles, recommendations for professional learning communities, etc. By the way, this PowerPoint is going to be available to you through UnidosUS, and then the supporting documentation, if you're interested in any of those documentation, any of the documents, I'd be happy to get those to you as well. But we'll work through UnidosUS. And then again, this is how we're kind of looking at our advanced program planning, our building the pipeline for bilingual educators, strengthening the expertise of our bilingual educators, and then strengthening family and community engagement. One of the things that's not reflected in this PowerPoint yet, and I apologize, is that in New York City, what I said to our folks and my colleagues is that we are not about parent engagement. I really don't want to engage parents. And you might be thinking, wait, what is he saying? You don't want to engage parents? Look, a parent engagement is a really easy bar. I can engage a parent in 2 seconds flat. Deny them entrance into that gifted program that they want to get into. That parent is going to be engaged, right? So parent engagement is very simple, and it lets us off the hook as an institution. What we are about is, I want to create activists in every one of my parent communities. I want to be about parent empowerment. And how do you empower parents? You empower them through knowledge. The most privileged parents that I interact with on a daily basis are not my most wealthy parents in New York City, although there are a good modicum of them. They are the parents that have the knowledge to advocate for their children. They know who to talk to. They know who to email. They know what the email should look like. They know if they get a no answer, who do they go to next? You see, they have knowledge. They know what their students should be learning in the first grade, and if they're not happy with that, I get 20 emails saying, I want to switch my child from this first grade teacher to that first grade teacher because they're not. See, knowledge is power. We want our parents, and unfortunately, many of those parents that are engaged are not the parents that look like me or you. So we want to empower our parents to be activists, because I think that helps the system get better. And then what makes our bilingual program so successful? This, again, another representation of the different aspects. What I would say to you about our bilingual programs is, number one, we collectively as an educational community, and I am thrilled that in this room we have educators that are elected officials. But by and large, the electorate is not comprised of educators. So while education has become politicized, it's not always politicized around good outcomes for kids. It's politicized around good outcomes for elective results for adults. So we as educators, and I think you have in Arizona, this incredible, incredible momentum, have started to reclaim that education space. What's good for children? How do we fund it? How do we support it? And then how do we talk about it in no uncertain terms about what does the research say? How does that research align to what we want to do? And then how do we collectively advocate in terms of what we're trying to do for our children. Now, because I get to come in and then fly out, I already told you one thing that I would do if I was still in Arizona. I would rally every one of my educator friends to push back against that four-hour block. It's not research-based, it's not enlightened practice, it's political practice. The second thing that I would do is I would encourage my colleagues, my friends that are superintendents in this room. How many school districts are there in Arizona? You can put every one of those superintendents in some conference room somewhere. Get into a conference room, come together and develop your policy for the children and families of Arizona. And as a united group, take that to the legislature. Because you see, they can pick us off one at a time. But when we are collectively together and say, we agree on four or five platform ideas, and I know what the conversation is going to be. Well, we are big schools, we are small school systems, we're rural school systems, we're urban school systems. Yes, absolutely, that's a beauty. But you can still come up with four or five policy recommendations that united as a united community, you can actually move in this time of opportunity that we have here in Arizona, my home state. So with that, I just want to say thank you for the opportunity to share a few words with you. I'm really excited about what's coming up next because we have an incredible panel of really high-powered, super smart people that I respect in education that are going to talk about educational policy. So if you're ever in New York City, come out and say hi. And again, it's great to be back in Arizona, mi tierra natal. Thanks for the time.